Test. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Is my mic on?
What you got, that herpes syphagana leg? You up here coughing. Stop that.
Don't be disrespectful. Test. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2.
Do I need to get tested?
1, 2.
Testing. Do we need some testing done?
I can hear you very clearly.
Hi, my name is Reggie Reg, and you're listening to the Hawk&bel Podcast.
Good evening, good afternoon, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to the Hawk&bel Podcast.
Woo woo.
On 30, produced by 30 Parkwood. We are on YouTube. I would like to say I'm very happy to be here. I'm a little bothered because I can't really hear myself with my headphones, but it looks like I'm registering okay on the computer. Hello, Bel.
Howdy, Greg.
How art thou?
Wie heißt du?
See, I'm speaking Old Testament. You end up bringing... What language was that?
That was German.
German. Say it again, what's the word?
Wie heißt du?
Shout out to all the military families that had to adapt and adjust and learn various languages in order to survive in the world today. We have a good show to give you all. You know, last week we gave you all dumb news and things of that nature. We changed up the format just a little bit. Today, we're just going to talk about two subjects. The first subject we're going to talk about is, does a husband and wife have to be best friends? And does it make for a better relationship? And of course, that topic, is it Do husband and wife. Don't judge me in my grammar.
Do
husband.
Not does.
You know, tomato, tomato. So we're going to talk about that in our first segment. And then in our second, we're going to take a break. And then in our second segment, we're going to talk about problems in interracial relationships. And there's nothing scientific about it. It's just Bel and I discussing things that we've learned and things that we've encountered being in a relationship just in general. Can we dig it?
Dig
that. Listening to Hawk&bel Podcast on 30 Parkwood.
Hi, this is Regina with Simone B. Catering, and you're listening to the Hawk&bel Podcast.
Is this the life that I signed up for? Is it worth it? Oh yeah, it's worth it. Where they don't have to grow up like us, yeah, that's a blessing. And I don't wanna see them go through hell when they could be in heaven. Heaven, yeah. I'll be going on my own, yeah, yeah. Leaving everything I know. My life, views of my life. Okay. I'm in the skylight. I guess it's what they mean by the highlight. Went to Vegas, didn't care about the nightlife. Killing these shows and flying right back to my wife. Back on the ground, back on the grind. Songs got the right, I can't keep them inside. Songs that we're making not only for rating, cause honestly, my fam can't eat your legs. What should I do? What should I say? I asked the father, he told me keep writing. Set Fern in this life with this talent I gave you. You gon' only many to me, that's a promise if we're being honest. I haven't been perfect, but Lord, you have always been there when I needed you. I've been through hell and high water, consistently let you down, but you love me through. You tell me I'm your son. How did I deserve such grace? Me, I sold cocaine that would numb your brain to the point you say how much blow you take. Firm, bruh, that's enough with the drug talk. That's for those still stuck in a drug walk, feeling distant, debt to the world cut off. Here's a song just for you to help you go on.
I'll be going on my own, leaving everything I know.
You're listening to the Hawk and Bel Podcast.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. You're listening to the Hawk and Bel Podcast on YouTube, produced by 30 Parkwood. I am Hawk, if you didn't know, and to my right is
Bel.
So please don't get our names mixed up. Don't call me Bel in the streets. You know what I'm saying? That's disrespectful.
I didn't realize I had that much bass in my voice.
Well, I'm actually on the mix. I'm trying to adjust for that. Hopefully, I'm not coming off as bassy this time. We had some comments. Shout out to Carlos Los, who said that I was overmodulating last time. So, you know, it's a work in progress, ladies and gentlemen.
Stop hugging the mic.
I'm resting it on my stomach. It's a natural table. So, this Syrian conflict that's going on, we just launched as of the recording of this podcast yesterday. As a matter of fact, 50 missiles was launched from U.S. into a Syrian airstrip over, and the reason that was given to us is because of the chemical warfare that was going on. That I don't know. Do you know how many people were killed this time around?
I believe after the missiles were launched this time around from the U.S.?
No, the based on...
Or the nerve gas.
The nerve gas.
I want to say about 70 was the tally.
And this isn't the first time that this has happened. Their President Assad, had launched another chemical back in 2011, I believe.
Yeah, it was like 11 or 12, I think.
So this isn't anything new. President Trump gave the go-ahead and, you know, and did what many people believe to be is the right thing in terms of protecting the Syrian people because of that kind of dictatorship.
Well, the thing was, I mean, they were supposed to have gotten rid of that nerve gas back then, and they never did, obviously, because now we have this situation that's recently occurred.
Yeah, I've heard rumors that when Bush accused Iraq of having certain type of weapons, nuclear weapons or things like that, that he didn't have in Iraq because, or excuse me, not Bush, but Bush accused Hussein at the time, he moved his weapons to Syria and they were essentially hiding for him. So that's where, you know, I don't know, hearsay, I guess. I didn't read any official reports behind it, but I'm not against what has happened. It's just emotionally for me, I just don't want to see any of our fellow brethren out there fighting and getting into something that we shouldn't be getting in front of. And that's difficult for me to say because, again, the atrocities that's going on in Syria, that's been going on for so long, 7 years or so, you know, I would like, for me, I'm definitely a social liberal when it comes to issues like that. I'm all about protecting people, but I just want to be some consistency from the American government, especially if Trump saying that he doesn't want refugees to come inside the country, yet he's eager to launch missiles into their country to protect them. I feel like there's a conflicting of a message there. You know,
I definitely get that, but my biggest concern is more so for our military troops. First thing I thought when I heard the news that he had just launched missiles overseas was, oh my goodness, are we at war? Are we going to war?
Right.
I mean, that's just happened so many times within my lifetime. And I've had so many people so close to me involved in war my whole life that it's nothing that I just wink at when I hear something of that nature.
It definitely has a different feeling now than it did back in the day. So when I was in the military, Ladies and gentlemen, I got diabetes, so I forget words from time to time.
Is your sugar low?
Yeah, my sugar's low. That's what's acting up. But the what is the word? It's at the tip of my tongue. If war was imminent, and as Marines or troops, we knew that it was imminent, we got excited. We knew, okay, this is what we signed up for. It's time to go.
Kill blood.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah. That was the attitude. But now that I'm older, I feel like I have a bigger picture, because it's not just about me and the people around me that's training, because these people are now attached to, as you expressed, families, and they're attached to their wives, and they're attached to the kids and their mothers and fathers. And it's like, yo, if they die, they're not the only ones that's affected by this.
Not only that, if they don't die, but we're the ones that they come home to.
Right.
We're the ones who nurture and take care of them, and daddy can't run around and play with me no more because he's missing a leg. You know, mom's over here nurturing her husband's wounds, you know, or dealing with, I'm not staring at two eyeballs now, I'm staring at one eyeball and a replacement. I mean, definitely a whole lot to deal with, a whole lot to consider. And it is definitely very tough constantly seeing this side of war living in a military town.
Yeah. So again, you won't get any criticism in terms of a policy on our standpoint. We just pray and we hope for the best for our troops and soldiers that's out there doing the best that they can. Now it's just about mission completion. Do your jobs, come home safely, and make sure that you train your troops right so that we're all in this and we're working together. It's not about being a Republican or a Democrat. It's about being safe. But I gotta have one conspiracy.
Oh.
As I'm talking to you. So as we're protecting the so-called Syrian government, and when I say not, I'm not talking about President Assad, but democracy, because I'm assuming this is why America is getting involved, so that dictatorship will not rule and they're protecting the people.
I don't know. I don't even want to presume why we're getting involved.
Because
my thought process is not that there's motivation for the American people, but more so self-motivation and monetary means that are being protected.
All that. But on a very basic, for me, on a very basic level, it's funny how we can see these things across the water. And Flint, Michigan is still dealing with their water issues. And this has been going on for almost just as long as that Syrian conflict that's going out there. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're not familiar, Flint has been getting sick kids. And we don't even know the long-term effect of what's going on in terms of the water because of the lead levels that was in there, the pipes that need to be changed out. I did a podcast about this particular issue a long time ago. I'm not going to repost it, but if you get a chance, just look into the history of how that is going on and the corruption that's going on. And it's like, we can't even deal with that yet. We can throw 50 missiles in Syria. So I just, you know, I have a little reservation about that part, the domestic versus the international issues. But otherwise, you all stay safe. Keep the morale up. Oorah, Marines. Come home safe. J-Lo at one point had insured her behind. And I've heard other celebrities have insurance on their body parts.
Yes. Models do that.
That is
their
amazing.
Hands. I hear a lot, about insuring your hands or your feet, like if you're a foot model, teeth and things of that nature. Yeah.
So if I injure something that is of value, on my body if I'm a hand model.
That's their money maker.
Let me find out, man. So if that doesn't answer your question, Bel, if you could get insurance on a body part, what would you get insurance on? Or what could you get insurance? What would the insurance company be like? Yeah, I'm gonna insure that on you.
Well, let's look at it from another perspective. What would you like insured on me, sir?
What that mouth do?
No.
Take that joint.
No.
Probably your lips. Yeah, probably your lips. I'm not saying that's your best feature, but it's something that I really enjoy. Not sexually, but smile and stuff like that. So, yeah, we gotta ensure that. Let's look into that. Something to do this week. All right, so let's talk. Let's get into our first topic. Actually, let's take a break, and then we'll get into our first topic, which is, I'm not even going to say it because grammatically I got corrected. Ladies and gentlemen, listen to the Hawk&bel podcast on 30 Parkwood. You're listening via YouTube, and we'll be right back.
Got it! Wake up, wake up. Mindset, cake up, cake up. Gotta get a couple dollar before I get follow in a white band take up. See, we taking chances, saying in advancing. Reach for our hand and now we on the moonlight dancing. Yeah, yeah, and we sold. I done traded life for my soul. But till you walk a mile in my soul, your responses shouldn't be cold. I got money here, it don't fold. I got shooters up in my fold. Yeah, I'm sticking to the G code. See, the story here will be told. See, this life is all that I know. Yeah, 100's all that I go. Every day I'm checking that scope, leaving bodies all on that flow. Yo, they say I'm Tony with it, they acting phony with it. You want my life, well you feel lucky, try to come and get it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Protecting the zipper with every short breath that you're passing away. I call me your body, I tell for the rally, got nothing to say. Just throw me in hell, I mean throw me in jail. I'm stuck in this nightmare, but trapped in a cell.
Don't you wake me up, don't you wake me up, please. Having dreams of the best life in that luxury. Dreaming. Living good with closed eyes. Not realizing the price paying for paradise. Wait 1 minute, hold up, this dream getting too hard to bear. Suddenly my dream turned into nightmares. Dreaming. Put it down for that eight times.
Yeah. I'm dancing on the street corner. Yeah. Chain link fence to the backdrop. Gold chain showing that he a baller. Gym sock stuff full of crack rocks. My whole life I wanna be that. Tall white tee and some fresh Nikes. My life different, gotta be glad. Lord came and it was oh so timely. Uncle just got out of prison now. And you know I copied everything. My parents lost and they don't know how. All this stuff getting in my brain. Clayton County public schools is realer than the videos on MTV and BET. So you know how the story goes. The city full of nightmares, Riverdale. It's a good time, but it's a living hell. I was picked on for my white skin, so I would knuckle up in my life of sin. Went taking that so we could get this scrap. And I lost a lot, but I earned respect. Eventually, your boy started rapping. Outcast staying off in my deck, I loved it. Idolizing everything about street life. In the south, we was taught to get toe up under them street lights. My first blunt, I was 14 with them red eyes in the backseat. 3 years later, I woke up when the Lord came and he saved me. No more dreaming.
Don't you wake me up, don't you wake me up, please. Having dreams of the best life in that luxury. Dreaming. Living good with closed eyes. Not realizing the price paying for paradise. Wait 1 minute, hold up, this dream getting too hard to bear. Suddenly my dream turned into nightmares. Dreaming. Put it down for that eight times. Gotta walk back and some switch lane with my talk down.
Wake up, mindset, cake up, cake up. Gotta get a couple dollar before I get followed in a white man take up. Wake up, wake up. Mindset, cake up, cake up. Gotta get a couple dollar before I get followed in a white man take up. Wake up, wake up. Mindset, cake up, cake up. Gotta get a couple dollar before I get followed in a white man take up. Wake up, wake up. Mindset, cake up, cake up. Gotta get a couple dollar before I get followed in a white man take up.
Alright, we're back. You're listening to the Hawk&bel Podcast, 30 Parkwood Productions on YouTube. are now getting to our first topic, which is, do husbands and wives have to be best friends, and does it make for a better relationship? Thank you, Dawn of J&D Catering. And I only shout out her business out there because she's a business owner. And you know, they get out there and they work and they get it. But she submitted this topic because I put the call out there for listeners and friends and family members to, you know, give us some ideas in terms of topics to talk about. So let's get your perspective. How do you feel about it?
I don't think so. I do not believe that a husband and wife need to be best friends in order to make things work. And I actually think it kind of hampers the relationship.
Oh, you're going all the way in. Did you do some research on this topic?
No, that's my personal thoughts. You are not my best friend, and I don't think that that would work.
So I'm going to stick to my original answer so that we just kind of get the perspectives. But in reality, I finally understand what you mean with your answer. So from my perspective, I originally thought, yeah, of course, a husband and wife have to be best friends. And as a matter of fact, actually, before you and I discuss it, let's read a couple of replies that we got on Facebook. All right, so this is from Sadidra. Shout out to Sadidra, program director at BronkRadio.com, where every second of the day an artist is live. That comes automatic. And she wrote, yes. I was just having this conversation with someone, and it also depends on what your definition of a best friend is. Y'all can have two different meanings. Hero, also from Fayetteville State University, he wrote, it's kind of lengthy, but I'm going to go ahead and read it out. He used some words in here, Bill. SAT-ish. Yes, marriage can be seen as an agreement of sorts. The substance of the agreement can be platonic or romantic. Romance becomes the Yes, marriage can be seen as an agreement of sorts. The substance of the agreement can be platonic or romantic. Romance becomes the fuel which either keeps it going or destroys it in various ways. I'm sure you've seen examples of bad marriages which run on sex. Pernicious to vitolic or vitolic. That means bitter, but I don't know how to pronounce it. But marriages based on platonic love, friendship, are more steady, hence the low divorce rates between arranged marriages. Their foundation is platonic, not romantic. Romantic love, sex runs on desire. When said desires are not met, problems ensue. But platonic love is based on the understanding of common interests, compatible personalities, etc. Understanding is higher, desire is lower, happiness more possible. IMO. I don't know what IMO stands for. Millennials, stop using initials on, I don't know what those things mean. You know what IMO mean?
In my opinion.
As it came to me right before you said that, like, oh, okay. Kind of common sense. Whatever. Stop using that. Lisa. Shout out to Lisa. Personal friend of ours. Also a writer. I don't know the name of the company that she's writing for right now. But she's one of my more favorite writers. Also a student of Fayetteville, or ex-student. Graduated student of Fayetteville State University. She wrote, absolutely, you should be able to turn to your spouse just as you would a completely platonic best friend. They should be someone you can confide in, who builds you up, who understands you, and who knows your details as any best friend would. So your spouse should basically be your best friend, who you just find very attractive. And one more response, and this is from somebody in California. Shout out to Nicolette. She wrote, for my relationship, because one thing that I know for sure, everyone's is unique like a fingerprint, being best friends is literally the foundation of our relationship. Sometimes I don't like him as a husband, but I am sure he has moments where I fail him as a wife. But the fact that we built our marriage on our friendship means that we like each other more than we love each other sometimes. When our marriage has failed, we manage to be friends through it and work on repairing the love. Without that, for us, I'm 100% sure we wouldn't be together. And that together is 18 years married after knowing each other only 4 months.
Wow. Big ups for them 18 years.
Big. And that's not the first time I've heard that. Elder Baker said he met his wife after 3 months.
I know my folks got married after 6 months of meeting each other and knowing each other in college.
And you know what? At this point in my... Well, so I have to be... In my case, I have to be a little older. But, like, I know what I know and I like what I like. So, for sure, I can see, like, why are we wasting our time? You know what I mean? Like...
Hello. We get married at a young age. You can say that now.
Right.
At the age that you're at.
Right.
But I don't think you could say that back then.
Oh, it wouldn't know. Not even.
I know we definitely didn't hook up because we were best friends or even friends to begin with. So.
Yeah. We kind of went out of order. And
very much so.
It's not something that I struggle with, but it is something that sometimes it becomes a little regretful in terms of, like, I in some ways cheated you because I introduced the sex first without, well, I tried to introduce myself, you know what I mean? I was trying to be that friend and
yeah, that okay.
I did. I tried to bring both aspects to it, but
you know, a dude will say anything to get in a girl's drawers. So
was that my case?
Were you putting your best foot forward as being a friend or your best foot forward as being a male?
No, being a friend. Because when we met, like I told you, it wasn't about the sex at all. I wasn't trying. After you all had cooked and did all that, I was like, man, this is just
yeah, cool. We were just chill, huh?
Yeah, it was super cool. Now you the one that invited me into the bed. Yeah, you can spend a night. So what else we gonna do?
Did I say that? My roommate say that?
You didn't stop it fast. Yeah. We talk about my business, but you don't want to talk about your business anyway. So let's go back to your response in terms of you said that I'm not your best friend, or you're saying you don't have to be best friends in order to be a successful marriage. Clarify that for me.
Yeah, you don't have to be in a position of being best friends for a marriage to be a success. And no, I wouldn't want you to be my best friend per se. My confidant, yes. My desired, my love, yes, definitely. But the best friend, I see it more as somebody where I go and I kind of bounce ideas back and forth. I kind of get clarity for my ways of thinking or whatever I'm dealing with. And then I can come back to you with the passion that I need, with the energy that I need to help us continue to build. Like, I don't want to look at you in the sense of kind of like a dumping ground, for lack of a better way
right.
of expressing it. But a lot of times that's what friends do. You dump your problems or your issues or your concerns or whatever. And it's not a definite idea. But it's not a definite position or stance that you take when you go to your best friend and you share all these things with them. Like I said, it's kind of like a bouncing ground where you're getting feedback from that person. And the best friend part is that you would hope that they have your best interest when they give you that feedback. You take, you know, and pick from the bone. Of course, some people will eat the bone, but generally the point is to pick the meat from the bone when you get that advice.
I so wanted to be the opposing voice in this. However, as I was doing some biblical reading as well as some psychological research or research through the psychology of marriage and mm-hmm. understanding that, everything that you said, I agree with, and I understand that perspective. Now, I do got my original perspective is I didn't personally understand how a relationship can work if a wife didn't consider the husband to be the best friend and vice versa, because as you and I discussed earlier or before, if we discuss or we talk about, you mentioned being a confidant, we talk about and we're there for each other in the most private moments, in the most crucial moments. We're building our finances together. We're raising a child together. Like, those things are so intimate and so personal that like, who else are you going to go and talk to, or who else can you turn to in those dark moments and or in hard times? And, you know, like, I thought at first, I thought that by not considering your spouse your best friend, it's almost treason. Like, who does that? Why is my iPhone picking up our conversation? Look at this. Considering your... Why is Siri answering my question?
Because she's not Sergio. Sergio is advanced.
Everything you need to know about Apple products is at Apple's website.
That is so spooky. Oh, man. Anyway, so the...
You said treason. Maybe that's a trigger word.
Oh, Trump is picking up on my words. Hey, look, man. We can't afford missiles over here, so you ain't gonna worry about this. But those were my original thoughts, and as I looked at the psychology and the biblical aspect of it, I understand more where you're coming from. And as to the point, now, before I talk about the biblical, the psychological part is, I was reading a psychologist, a therapist, and she was saying when couples come in for counseling and they talk about friendship, and most likely it's one of the spouses that is most effective. And so when a relationship starts failing, there are some
that they're most effective or most affected.
Affected.
Oh, okay.
There's one spouse that's more affected than the other spouse, most likely.
Generally, yeah.
Yeah, generally.
One has the gripe, where the other one's clueless.
Yes. And so one of the things that, so there's many factors that come up in terms of the, like, what causes a marriage to fail. There are some commonalities all across the board. But the one thing, and this is not, this what I'm about to say doesn't attribute towards a failed relationship, but more of a personal unfulfillment. So when one spouse is personally unfulfilled, the sex, time spent with each other, those things are factors, but they're not the biggest factor. The biggest factor, surprisingly, is considering the spouse to be the best friend because there's a lack of fulfillment in the other spouse. So in other words, the spouse is trying to, because the spouse is unfulfilled, they put all their expectations on the other spouse, expecting them to bring that in. Does that make sense?
Yeah, to fill that void and to be that rebound kind of person.
And sometimes, see, the unfulfillment is not, maybe it's not because there's something lacking in that person. Maybe it's because they love their spouse so much that they gave up something that they personally love in order to help the other person or to share a like with that person, even if they don't like it. And so
they've lost themselves within that person.
They lost themselves. And so because of that, that means they put all of their energy into the other person. And it's almost not fair, but then that's when that resentment comes in. And then, okay, now the relationship is going downhill and everything's been affected by that. So
it's easy to lose yourself when you are in a position where you play so many roles. And yet you're one in the same, whether it's you're playing the wife role or the mother role or the housekeeper role or the financial administrator role. It's easy to lose yourself within that.
I saw all that. It was some many things that you've often complained about. And recently we talked about time that is not given for yourself. Every time you get a free moment between myself and Olivia, or
there is nothing left for yourself.
And so because in this case, in this personal example for you, you have no time for yourself. That means that you don't have time to invest. So now, if I was the best friend, if I was considered that person, you're trying to bounce your feelings and your ideas off the very thing that the issue is occurring from, which is cool because we got to talk it through. However, sometimes it's good just to have an outside ear to give you perspective. And that's what a best friend is supposed to do. A best friend is supposed to give you perspective. Mm-hmm. And now I get it. That best friend is supposed to be that outside the circle, outside the circumstance to bring that balance. And so now you said it. Okay, now I worked it out. I found what my passion is. Now I can bring it back into the relationship and we can continue to build on.
So it doesn't matter if it's a male or a female best friend?
Oh, definitely. Yeah, no, don't. We ain't talking no more. Yeah, I call my boo. I bet my male. No, we're not doing that. I think it's very healthy to have a same sex best friend, but because so.
Well, I mean, I have my brother that I speak different. To as a a good friend.
No, that's different. That's your family. So
yeah, that is family.
Yeah, I can't even consider that. But if we're talking about another person outside of your family, because and the primary problem with that is that when you're sharing deep emotional feelings and you're sharing and connecting that with somebody that's outside, you can almost lead to that emotional cheating where it's like he's getting the stuff that I'm supposed to be getting. You know what I mean? And it's like now you're building and you're connecting with this person over here where that's supposed to be for me on my side. I don't know for other marriages, you know.
Take care of the shop or someone will take care of it.
Yeah, shout out to them. No, we're not going to do that. We're not doing that at all. I kind of want to change the subject now that you introduced it. I don't want to talk about this no more. But let's take a test. You want to take a test?
Oh, Lord.
I found a test. I haven't previewed it. I just kind of saw the first couple of questions. I thought it was pretty interesting. Just to, you know, just for fun and giggles, and then we'll take a break. And this test is called... What's it called? 21 questions to test how well... you really know your partner.
Oh boy.
Well, we're doing this on air. Yeah. So I guess what we do is I'll ask the question and then you and I will answer individually and then we'll go to the next question. Cool?
Cool.
All right, here we go. Some of these questions might be too personal to be broadcasted. For me, it's not. For you, it might be. So let me know. Just give me, you know, a heads up and then we'll just skip on. What's your partner's least favorite body part?
We were just talking about this.
What is my least favorite body part, Bill?
Your least favorite body part?
Yeah, this is about you getting answers to your spouse.
Oh, just was. Your feet? I don't know.
Wow. No, I love my feet.
Do you?
I do. Now, to your credit, though, that was...
You had a big aversion to feet. So.
I had a complex. I had a super complex about my feet. And it was just because I had toenail fungus. And toenail fungus is so disgusting, dude. It makes your feet look like you're part of the troll family. It's just not cool. So, you're correct, but your answer is a little outdated. Now, it would definitely be my stomach. But it's not even close.
You didn't have a stomach when I met you.
So. Yeah. So, that... And I don't care. And for me, it's not about the appearance, but when men who have bigger stomachs are more prone to heart disease, they're more prone to diabetes, it's just a correlation that was there, and I'm going through that. So, yeah, it'll be my stomach. Okay. Am I answering this question for you, or am I moving on?
You can't.
So, my partner's least favorite body part, stomach. So yep. It's not even...
It's always been that since I was a child.
Yeah. So, that's not even a hard one. Number two, when your partner was a child, what did they want to be when they grew up? So, I'll go first this time. I still kind of... I know the answer to this, but I don't agree with it for whatever reason. If, based on you, you always saw yourself... No. So there was a change of thought, though. Ooh. Wait a minute. So my original answer was going to be you wanted to be a housewife. But that wasn't your answer as a child.
No, because I never wanted to be married.
Right. So, and now I'm going based on what you told me. You didn't say what you wanted to be, but you always saw yourself in a lab coat and high heels.
No. That was a dream I had of conflicting thoughts of what I wanted to be. Business or in the medical field. So, okay. And that was later on.
So what did you want to be when you grew up? So then I don't know.
Your guess is as good as mine. I never aspired or had any desires for anything. My mind was never on that.
Right.
I had a whole lot that I went through as a child, and I was more focused on taking care of my mom and my brothers and just the stuff that we dealt with. So I didn't actually aspire to do anything.
So I'm on it. All right. So what's your answer, young lady?
What you wanted to be when you grow up?
Yeah.
A football player?
Nope. I wanted to be a police officer.
Oh, okay.
Yep. It was between that or an actor.
I think we spoke about that before.
Yep.
Yeah.
Name a country your partner would love to visit. And again, I know the answer to this because we just got through talking about it. I want to say it was Italy. Am I correct?
A place that I would like to visit?
Yeah.
No.
You wouldn't like to go to, because we were talking about the food.
No, Italy is extremely expensive. No, and there's a bunch of little cars and people don't know how to drive.
Again, no. Country, the question is, name a country your partner would love to visit. Not an island.
Asia.
Oh, that's
right. Hello, that's the right. Food I love, Japan. The right. Culture, hello.
We just talked about that yesterday, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, my bad. All right, your turn.
A place you would like to go to? Yeah. Africa.
By far. It's not even close.
Now where? You gonna go see the Bushmen we were talking about?
Now that we saw that documentary, I would.
Greg thinks he's part of the Kalahari.
Part of the people of Botswana.
The Kalahari people, yeah.
Did your partner have a nickname as a child? What was it? Bonus point, did they like the nickname and why? You go first.
For you?
Yeah.
I'm sure they might have had a nickname or two. I don't think... Well, I don't know. Because you've gone by two different names generally most of your life, depending on where you're at or who you're interacting with. If they're people from school or personal friends, you can tell by what they call you. So
correct.
I don't know.
Yep. And the reason is, as a child, I really didn't have a nickname. I had a nickname growing up. I mean, when I became more like high school and up, but not as a child. So on your behalf, I know your family had names for you. And the only name that came to my mind is La Negra. That's the only one that I'm thinking about.
That's, I think, one of the most used ones. But everybody within my family had a different nickname for me. My dad had one that I did not like. And it, just thinking about it makes me laugh, though. You watched the show Cops, the cartoon back then?
Yeah, of course.
You remember Turbo Tuto?
Yeah.
That was one of my favorite characters. But he used to call me Turbo Tuto. I wasn't so fond of that nickname. But yeah, everyone has a different name. Even my brothers, they call me different things. The latest, I think, is Mobile Doll Gundam Wing.
Which of your parents, aunts, or uncles are they closest to? And so, I'll go first this time. Am I talking about this or no?
Say it again.
The question is, which of your partner's aunts or uncles are they closest to? So, am I talking about this?
Who are you closest to in your family?
Yeah, and who are you closest to in terms of aunts and uncles?
Yeah, you can say that. I don't care.
So, for you, your original uncle that you was really... And, well, can I say that? You was really close. You had a gay uncle, right? That died of HIV?
I don't know if he was gay. I speculated he was gay, but no, he wasn't the person I was most close to. I was most affected by his death.
Okay.
But he wasn't the person that I was most close to.
Okay.
As far as family member?
Yeah, yeah.
My grandma, I'm really close to my grandmother and my uncle, Chael.
Your uncle Chael would have been my second guess, but yeah, that would have been my second guess.
Yeah, he did a whole lot for me growing up. I remember him just always having an active role within my life.
So for the record, did I get that wrong, right or wrong?
Wrong.
All right. What about me? Closest uncle, aunt? I don't think that question really applies to me though, because I didn't have.
I would say Mike. Big ups to Uncle Mike.
I would say no, because I only met Mike when I was a senior in high school. So he's not somebody I grew up with. You know what I mean? So in the truest sense.
Well, in reality, you didn't grow up with anybody like that. You didn't have anyone consistent in your life. But I would say he's been one of the most consistent people within your life that even I've met and interacted with. And even Olivia has met and interacted with.
This is my question, Bel. How are you going to tell me?
I'm telling you why I said the answer I said.
Shout out to Mike. You know, next question. What disappointment or rejection from your partner's past still stings? Ooh. What disappointment or rejection from your partner's past still stings? Oh, man. Did I go first or you go first?
You go ahead and go first.
What disappointment or rejection from your partner's past still stings? So, rejection... That's the biggest word for me. I don't know if I can talk about that. I'm not gonna say the situation. You'll know though. Coming from your father, I'm thinking about two scenarios. But put it like this: anytime your father is angry and is projected directly towards you.
Yeah, I would say that's a big sting.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The one in college,
mm-hmm.
and a teenager. Yeah.
So. Yeah, I would say that was pretty tough to overcome. Yeah. It doesn't bother me now if I come across that letter,
right?
And I reread that. Yes, definitely, I relive a moment, and it's very hurtful as a child. But I guess that's just the only way he knew how to express himself at the time being. So, for you, I would say...
It's too many. I got a gang of those, so... Yeah.
Well, no, I think, you know, especially now linking it with the police officer aspirations, when you didn't get accepted out here to be part of the police force.
Ooh, I didn't even think about that, but...
But I know that just reliving those moments and thoughts of what you went through after that situation, especially since you passed everything till the last point, I think was very, very hard for you.
So what Bel is talking about, because this is part of my testimony, at this point, I had gotten kicked out the military and I was actively searching for a career and fulfillment. And when I got rejected by the Fayetteville Police Department, that was like the last straw. I felt like I didn't have anything else going on in my life. So, yeah, that was a major, major disappointment, rejection. You're right. I'm not going to do all 21 questions because, it'll be something you and I can talk about maybe off air. I think this is pretty cool. One more question. something easy or something more lighthearted. Of all the ways there are to die, which does your partner fear the most? So, you and I have not discussed this, but I bet you I can come up with a scenario. You being covered with roaches. That would be a horrible way to die. Easy. That's easy money. Give me that.
Oh, you make me want to cry just thinking about it.
Give me that. Yep.
Oh. Yeah, I think that'll do it. I'd rather be stabbed up or something.
Yeah.
Well, for you,
yep.
With a snake biting you.
Oh man, that plays into my phobia. So yeah,
you just played into mine.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I don't want to be anywhere near a snake. And then, ladies and gentlemen, it's not that.
So pretty, too.
No, the devil's
alive. Yes, they are. They come in so many different shapes, sizes. We just saw, what did we see yesterday? Was it Anaconda?
Yeah. We saw, it was a...
thing was huge.
Yeah, that thing was huge. But it was
like 5 meters or something.
If you find that snakes are pretty, I think psychologically there is something that you are missing. And you are not fulfilled in life.
Have you ever touched a snake?
Why would I do that? No.
I've held them. Snakes. An albino, the albino snakes. No. Oh, they're so pretty.
No. Anyway, so yeah, this was just and ladies, if you want to take or you want to just for conversation purposes, you and your spouse. I found this quiz on www.psychologytoday.com/blog/in practice. I just typed in test for your spouse, and this is what came up. So I'll post the actual link in the YouTube, not the comment section,
description box
in
below.
The description box, and you can click it and ask these questions. Really cool questions. We're not going to answer these questions, but another question was, what does your partner typically look forward to most about the weekend? For Bel, easily sleep. Who is someone your partner considers to be?
Is that even a reality?
Who is someone?
I think the aspirations of getting sleep, maybe.
Who is someone your partner considers to be a mentor, or who has been a strong positive influence on their professional development? And so
those are kind of boring, actually.
Well, that so for Mike, he would fall for me more under that category.
A mentor.
Yeah, because the way he moved in the system was something I definitely aspired. And I look toward and the way he handles business. So yeah, so let's finish. Let's close this segment out. Does your spouse have to be your best friend? Even though I said yes originally, it's because that
no.
In my original thought, it was, but I would definitely say no. They don't have to be your best friend. Your spouse just has to be your spouse, and they fulfill that role. Absolutely, I believe they are the confidant. I believe they are the closest person. To you, but it doesn't mean that they have to fulfill that role. It's okay to have a female or male, whatever it is, your best friend, and have somebody you can talk to. I didn't say the opposite sex. For me, it'll be another dude. It's okay for me to have a male best friend.
Same sex best friends.
Yeah. I absolutely believe in that. I absolutely believe that. as a matter of fact,
I've had many male best friends. That's sure. Why.
Yeah. I mean, I've had many female best friends, but that was before I was married. I did not maintain those types of relationships. The females that are closest to me now, i.e., Tiff McGruder, shout out to Scooter. I don't know. I can't think of any other females at this point. That's like there.
That you're consistently talking to?
Yeah.
I don't know.
And even with Tiff, it's not like so consistent is relative, right? So like once a month. You know what I mean? And that's not something because she's married also. So shout out to her husband James, who I think he shares my ideology also. We're not gonna have a whole bunch of because Tiff. She matter of fact, she lived by that. Tiff, I'm gonna put your business out there. She was like, yeah, I got a gang of male best friends and whatnot. And she generally was that person because she was a tomboy and all that. And James wasn't having it. Well, you're going to cut that down on me. It's just going to be you and I. So, yeah, I believe in that. So,
yeah, you kind of cut my best friend off too, Javi.
That was your best friend?
At one point in time, yeah. He was the only one I told you that he had shared hold with up. Me when my mom was still
hold
living.
Hold up. Your best friend cannot be a person you was romantically involved with.
Well, let me get to that, actually. We were best friends, so we felt that getting involved romantically, I guess, naturally was the next step. But there you go, ladies and gentlemen, it doesn't work. We were more friends than anything. We just thought that that was the next step to take, and it being together intimately didn't work. But yet we were able to manage a friendship.
I know a lot of people will go against you in that particular way. A lot of people who start out, I know there's a lot of females. I never saw him romantically. We were friends and we built up together and whatnot.
He was attractive. I just wasn't into him.
Yeah. No, that wasn't going to work. Oh, yeah, that's not. No. Maybe we'll talk about another time why. Yeah. Can you still be friends with your romantic other? Somebody you used to be romantic with?
We were.
Ladies and gentlemen, you listen to the Hawk&bel podcast produced by 30 Park on YouTube. And we'll take a break, listen to some hot tunes, and we'll be right back.
I just come to let y'all know, stop. Put some respect on. Hey.
Heartbreak. Got a brother feeling like 8-0s. No, sir. I never go west, it's already been paid for. Sin trying to bury me deep. I can't horse around with this stagecoach. Jockeying for my life when Christ on the cross had admitted his caseload. Man, trying to bury me deep. Man, it's trying to bury me deep. It's trying to bury me deep. Yo, heartless, guarded. I laid my cares down and you two stepped on my carpet. I tuck my tears in and you pull out of this artist. A paintbrush for the blind kids who can't see where their mind is. Chime in, I bet you I won't pick up. You was down to see me drown. Now I'm sipping a bit in this cup. Gotta keep it re-up till a brother see now. Until I don't remember you. Cry river to CA now. Until then, I'ma build my art and park up in your aisle. Keep my name in your brain. I'ma beat shame in your chest. Guess you guilt tripping, pill lifting. I hope that you'll never see rest. I'm a nightmare on M. Hell is what I wish you see. And never would I bail you out. I hope you burn to the third degree. What? Forgiveness? I don't do. Nope, I'ma make a scene. I know you hoping we make up. Like maybe it's Maybelline. But I'ma uncover, girl. Yeah, I plan to damage you. You hurt my heart, bro. I'ma make this tangible. Rip through flesh like an animal. Take fairy like a tambourine. Imagine you being my gasoline. Fuel for the words in my magazine. It's about to jump off no trampoline. Stomp your yard like a Sigma new. I'm making this clear like a plasma screen. I really have lost all care for you.
Hello? Yeah, man. Yeah, yo, man, you should have heard what he said, yo. It's like, and then her? Like, dog, that's unforgivable stuff, man. You right. It's tough, though, man. Like, yeah, you right. The cross. Gotta forgive, man. It's grace. You right. You right, yo. Gotta turn back to the cross. That's right, man. The gospel. I remember. Right, love covers a multitude. Gotcha.
Christ died so I could live. Huh. What you think that I rap for? What you think that I stand for? Misery ain't my anthem. I got no right to throw a tantrum. But Christ paid blood for my ransom. In him I'm handsome. I let my light shine like a lantern. I'm beaming, no willing. The old man is so silly. I walk a mean mile in his shoes, but I must not walk like a Gentile do. That's futile, new style. Foundation feeling like new town. Found in a city where few bow. Whole hood looking like a funeral. That's ill. Gotta speak truth when it gets real. That's favor for your neighbor, and that's how we see the body built. You can be angry, but sin not. You gotta let love set you loose. Cause if the sun goes down on that, then it's hard to untie that noose. Yeah, the devil been looking for a job, yo. And we don't want his fruit. We know what he produce. So don't build a stand for his juice. Go make something, you thief, to give to another brother in need. And throw grace all up in your speech. Cause we don't wanna see the spirit greed. Believers should be sharing that great commission. His mission inside my heart. We've been sealed for the day of redemption. This clay up beside these dogs. We tell that bitterness to be gone. Wrath gotta go too. All that anger and clamor and slander has no use. We ain't tripping. We ain't tripping. We letting our soul glow. But we ain't dripping, flipping. Everything the world say. Try to tell me how to live life. I'm cool off of that, bruh. Cause I'd rather be dead right. Bright light shine with the love of Christ. Yep, yep. Forgive with the love of his. I know how to let go. Let go when I look at what he did. So I fix my eyes on that cross. Blood all of my thoughts. Love all of my lips. Don't believe me, just watch.
That's all I got, man.
Yep. Christ up.
ADFB. What's up, Jess? What's up, Bon? Sweet Mouse.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. You're listening to the Hawk and
Bel
Podcast on 30 Parkwood via YouTube. Thank you for continuing with us in our second topic. We're just going to get right into it. The problems with being in an interracial relationship. So let me start with a story, girl.
Are we in an interracial relationship? I thought love had no color.
That is a lie. And the test has proven that is a lie. Shout out to Maura Povich. So when I first met my wife, she was just a girlfriend at the time. She invited me to her house on base.
And they say she's just a friend.
And she was having a party. Context, I'm from California, where primarily there are Mexican brethren. Shout out to all my Mexican homies. In Cal, you say Mexican for some reason.
You say what?
Mexican.
Mexican?
Yeah, we don't pronounce the X for whatever.
We don't pronounce it in Spanish, so they translate it when they're speaking in English.
I'm talking about black folks. They wasn't Hispanic homies.
You are emulating the Hispanic people the way they say, I'm Mexican. That's Mexican.
No.
No?
No, because they do the H sound. They go, Mexico. That's how they pronounce Mexican. But we said Mexican.
No, when they read English. If they read Mexican in English.
I dig it. Well, anyway, so yeah, that's blacks and Mexicans. That's in the area that I lived at, Southern California, South Central LA, San Gabriel Valley. That's what it was.
SoCal.
So she invited me to her house. They're having a birthday party, I believe. And I go in there, and because it's a party, I'm thinking it's a time to turn up. And so I come in, and I did that loud as fire. And so her dad turns and gives me a very inquisitive look. Her stepmom gives me a very inquisitive look. I don't remember how Bel looked at me or she heard me when she was paying attention.
Oh, I was probably beat red.
Yeah. And so I'm like, why are they looking at me weird? You know what I mean? I'm thinking I'm giving it because that's what we did at Kinsietta's and things of that nature. And little did I know that there are very, very different and distinct cultural differences among our Spanish-speaking brothers and sisters.
Yes. But
I didn't know that. So I made my first mistake. Right off the bat.
Very, very different.
Right off the bat.
Cultures, especially being from the Caribbean.
Yeah. Like, I never...
Very different.
Ladies and gentlemen, let me be transparent.
And like, then my stepmother from South America. Yeah.
It didn't match.
You didn't translate nowhere in that atmosphere. You were about as Mexican as we were.
You know, that's all I know. Again, ladies and gentlemen, let me be transparent. I was completely ignorant when it came to Puerto Rico and its culture. I've never met anyone from there. I never seen Puerto. When I think of Caribbean, I think about Jamaica. That's really all I thought about was Jamaica.
Haiti, Cuba.
All that is now.
St. Thomas.
All that is now, but that wasn't my geography. Like, my geography didn't go. It's not that I didn't know my geography. It's just, you know, it's like it was a wallflower. It was there, like the island on the map was there, but it's like I didn't. It was a blind eye. Because when people say the Caribbean, I did think about St. Thomas, the Virgin Islands, and I thought about Jamaica. When I think about Caribbean, basically I thought about black folks, even though there's black folks in Puerto Rico, but you know what I mean, black folks. So once I met you and then I made that mistake and you corrected me about that, I started doing my research about Puerto Rico and really that area, and I was like, man, dude, there's so much. And so the more I learned about it, the one thing that really threw me off, side topic, was this happened when I was in the Marine Corps, seeing black people who look just like me speaking Spanish. That really, it still kind of throws me when I see that, you know what I mean, which is normal to you.
Well, I've always told you we're an island of colors, like the rainbow.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, from the darkest to the darkest to the lightest to the lightest. I mean, and that's not a barrier for us. We're still... Not to say that we don't have our biases or prejudices within our own country, but it's very distinct as to here in the U.S. and what is looked at.
That wasn't my exposure. So when I got in the Marine Corps, I met my first dark Hispanic brother. He was from Dominican Republic. His name was Adamas. And like I said, he looked to me, looked like all Dominicans to me look like light-skinned black folks. And when he never told me he was Dominican, but when we talked, there were some things he didn't relate to what I was saying. I'm like, why he didn't? I thought he was from the suburbs. And then when I walked by his room one day and he had some, it wasn't salsa. What's the Dominican Republic? What's the primary?
Bachata.
Bachata. He had that going on. And I was like, hey, dog. I'm from Cali too, but at the same time, I don't, you know, you playing that, like, that's your jam. And then he started speaking to me in Spanish. I'm like, oh, dude, you can speak Spanish? And he's like, yeah, I'm Dominican. And I'm like, yo. So it was a culture shock. I quickly had to speed up. And again, that was my embarrassing moment. And this is me having to learn about what it means to understand the culture that I'm supposed to be, you know, dating. And so one of my sensibilities in terms of learning you to know, to, for me, it was very important to know where you come from. And that's how I feel like I could get closer to you. Because, okay, so now I'm not sure if I can talk to you about sugar and Kool-Aid. And I'm talking about from traditional, stereotypical black folks. I'm not sure if I can talk to you about using baking soda as toothpaste or, I don't know, man. Whatever is associated with black culture, hip hop, you know what I mean? I don't know if I can talk to you about that. So I want, if I'm gonna have a conversation with you, culturally, where can I reach you?
How at? You say ghetto snacks?
Ghetto snacks.
Them ghetto snacks.
So, what Bell's talking about, me and my homies got high one day, and shout out to Memphis, because that was really his idea. And we were smoking, and we was talking about, man, all, so pickles and annihilators, Kool-Aid in grocery bags or in Ziploc bags, depending if you was bougie or not. And we was talking about all the ghetto snacks. And
so folks used to sell that in school when we was in overseas.
It was popping.
Or put it in their shampoo. Girls would put it in their shampoo to change their hair color.
Oh, they did. That's some jail stuff. They sure did, though. They sure did. I was in second grade, and girls used to put bubble gum under their fake nails to put it on their...
No. Yeah. I know.
They did that.
I've heard of folks doing it like earring backs. Like, you know, when you lose the back of your earring.
Putting bubble gum to hold it.
Bubble gum or erasers.
Yo, I had one dude in college. He was from New Jersey. I know he's going to listen to this, too. He went to FSU with me. I never told him this, but it was gross. I had him do a voiceover in the studio, and he had a gum in his mouth. I was like, hey, I can hear you chewing. So he took the gum and stuck it to the back of his ear. I'm like, hey, yo, whatever, let's go. It was his ear, so I was like, as long as it don't drop anywhere. But he did that. I was like, ugh, ghetto, nasty. But anyway, another interracial relationship. So that was me. That was one of the hurdles I had to jump over in order to kind of come up the learning curve. Do you have? I have a story. I don't know if you want to share it, though, because I know it hurts your feeling.
What?
The hotel.
What about it? I don't get it.
The cotton field.
You can go ahead and share it.
So, Bel, you sure you want me to share it?
You can. I don't care. I mean, it was my personal experience.
Right. And I'm with you on this one. So, Bel, coming from New York, right?
Yeah, I had moved out here from New York, Bay Ridge, Brooklyn.
And so she had came down here, it was within her first couple of weeks, and she was going to school in Greenville, going to ECU. And she began working at this hotel, and I'm not going to get into the whole details, but the big story is she was talking to a fellow co-worker, and the co-worker asked her, how you like being out here so far? And Bill was like, you know, it's different, it's the South, but I believe the cotton fields are so beautiful, long story short. And of course,
and they were, and they still are beautiful when I see them.
And so, and of course, she was talking to a black dude, and the black dude was like, what? Cotton fields are beautiful. Well, he didn't approach you like that, but he approached his manager. Because he didn't tell you, did he tell you he was offended?
No, he never told me he was offended. He just asked me, really, why? He just said a lot of people out here probably wouldn't look at it the same way. And that was that. I mean, but it didn't even cross my mind. At all, what he would perceive, or anyone out here for that part, other than the fact that they just have to work the fields, just like any other farmer or whatever has to work the fields out here. But I mean, I sincerely We drove into North Carolina August 17th. Never forget.
Never seen a cotton field before.
And I had never in my life seen a cotton field. And it was, I guess, ripe at that point and stuff. And it was just so pretty. So pretty.
Because it's just miles and miles.
I mean, all I saw was miles and miles of cars and buildings and cement, you know, in New York. So I didn't know what a plant was like that, especially not on the farm, just on the windowsill maybe, but you know, never that.
And again, when I look at a cotton plant, though I understand historically what went down to cultivate that, the same thing with tobacco or peas or whatnot, I don't have any type of, there's no emotional attachment to that plant. Like, I'm not going to go in a cotton field and get angry. It's still a plant at the end of the day. Like, if I was to get angry at every single thing that was used against black folks in terms of any type of racism, slavery, or whatnot, I just wouldn't be able to exist. Or the freaking cotton gin was created so that by a black person so that they wouldn't be able to so that the production of cotton would come faster. Mm-hmm. However, it in turn turned against us because it made us work harder anyway to fill it. Anyway, so anyway, I have no association. I don't care. I personally don't think cotton fields are beautiful just because I see what you're saying because of like this. It looks like rows of just white.
No, it had like, there was like, like the way the sun hit it, I don't know what it is. I mean, because like, again, I still don't know much about cotton. But it was like a purple cast.
Right.
It looked like a purple cast over the field, and then you got the white popping against it and stuff. And I don't know if maybe it was just the way the sun was hitting the area or whatever. Because along that same trip, too, the other thing I had never seen were peanuts.
Right.
You know, that was the other thing I had seen, peanuts. Nah. So, they just look very dusty.
I don't care about none of it. And maybe because I have been in the South for quite a while, and I think it's interesting. One of the most beautiful just sceneries that I've ever been to, the Southwest in terms of all that red clay and the red mountains. That to me, that was beautiful. But like cotton plants, you know.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not gonna like go pick a bushel of cotton and bring it to somebody as a bouquet.
Yeah.
You know, I think that would be a very racial charged gift.
Give it to me. Here you go, nigger. For you and your family. No, you're not gonna do that. But what in terms of dating me, what was one of the challenges from a cultural standpoint that you faced?
I honestly think it was the mixture of how Mexican you were.
Hilarious.
As far as like the influence of the culture and stuff that it had on you.
It was Cali.
But I didn't get that until your homie Vic came that weekend, and he was talking about tortillas with the chorizo. Oh, yeah. And I mean, I had never made chorizo. What do I know about that and tortillas or whatever? I didn't know, but you know, for y'all, it was like a no-brainer. Yes, tortillas go with this. So I guess that having that influence of what Cali was, but actually seeing you and hearing you say, I'm a black man. Well, what does that mean? And just really not knowing what that meant.
Oh, don't get it twisted now. I will tear up some cornbread. You know what I mean? Black eyed
peas. Oh, and that was another thing. Yeah, because you would always talk about soul food.
Right.
Soul food being your thing, but then you were sitting here talking about tortillas, and we'd go to a Mexican restaurant, and you'd have to interpret the menu for me. And stuff.
Can you dig that, ladies and gentlemen? I don't speak the lick of Spanish. I do speak that, but at that time, and that was something that threw me off because I'm like, Bill, the menu's in Spanish. Why don't you understand what it is? But it's because it was the type of food that you all don't serve.
I had never been introduced to that.
Yeah, so. There is a little bit of a trifecta that's going on now where it's not just me being black, but it's me being black and all the influences
and the influences that you brought to the table. Yeah, because I mean, I had been exposed to a lot of different influences being a military child, but Mexican was not one of them.
And that's interesting. Now, when I met you, you often talked about Germany, but I never felt like I had to learn German or German culture to get to know you better, even though you lived out there for 5 or 6 years, you know what I mean? And you spoke the language and you went to school and you loved the food and all that. But I personally didn't feel like I had to go that route to know you. That the Puerto Rican thing was definitely out there. And that was what I had to, you know, there was another thing that I had to overcome in terms of dating you in particular, as a, also as it pertains to your culture, the family structure. The father approval or the parental approval or just getting the okay from family. Like, that was something I've never, because I didn't grow up with a traditional family myself. I didn't have a consistent family member there. I never had to go through folks like that. You know what I mean? I never understood family structure. So I didn't know that dating you means that I have to get closer to all these different, you know, people and,
Look at it like this. Look at the Kardashians. I guess, you know, they're American here, but look at how involved each and every one of their family members has to be in everything they do or say. You know, they, where they have to have meetings of what's approved to be let out or not let out. Yes, of course, aside from the fact that they're making money, but the principle of family is what they're projecting, whether that's a reality or not.
So I don't like that example because I just, that family in particular, I just think it's a lot. Is a, and what you're saying might be true, but I see more just is more of a business related. When I learned about Puerto Rican culture, I started looking at Chinese culture and I started looking at Palestinian culture. I looked at just different foreign places outside of America. And what I found to be consistent is how important the family is versus American culture. There is an importance on family, supposedly, especially from the conservative, the far rights, they, you know, there's nothing more important than family, but they don't do it the way y'all do it. Not at all. Like, to the point where, and ladies and gentlemen, I'm putting a little bit of our business out there, but it's an appreciation for my point. If Bel was ever in a need, and if she was ever pressed for something, her dad doesn't even ask questions. He just provides and he's there. And he does that for each one of his kids. He's never asked for a thank you. He never has any expectations. And what I noticed with her family, her grandmother's the same way, her uncle Chael, even her uncle Angel, they all just move in a very tight circle. And I don't understand how anybody in their family could ever lack anything because of how tight-knit everybody is. Without being, and when I say tight-knit, I don't mean like they share all their emotions and they build that way, but it's the giving part is just so natural that, again, it's not something I'm used to. Like, oh yeah, go in the refrigerator, get you something to eat. Or even to this day, Bel and I have been married, and again, this is something else. This is kind of funny. I had to jump over. I feel like I'm doing more jumping than you are. So
I can't help it if I'm embracing.
So going to Bel's people's houses, I guess it's impolite to say no when it comes to their food.
Yeah, you don't say no.
And I did that repeatedly because I'm like, yo, I'm not hungry. And they will keep offering me plates of, hey, do you want this? Do you want this? Do you want this? I'm like, no, I don't. I don't want to eat. Leave me alone! And then Bel broke it down to me, like, traditionally in our culture.
Because it's kind of like you're rejecting them and what they have to offer. Like, whatever they have to offer is not good enough for you.
So I had to get used to that. I didn't realize that gesture, I thought I was just being me. And, you know, like, I have the right to say yes or no. And that's not it. I didn't know that. So, I guess I had to take a whole lot of turns and adjustments. Because
usually what we do, what we were brought up told is, like, you don't go to any foreign person's home to eat.
Yeah.
But you will accept a glass of water.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I mean, black culture, that's the same difference. Well, so the thing was, you don't go and eat at all. You eat at home, unless they're a family friend, and then you come back home. Whatever, don't be begging because you don't want to look like you're greedy. And so that was my mentality. I didn't want to go.
But not that you shouldn't eat though. Just don't be begging.
Don't be begging. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. That would, no, for us, you don't accept. Only a glass of water.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, there you go. So there wasn't, outside of that, there wasn't anything else that was difficult for you? You just, that, you know. I think that, so there's one thing you're not discussing, personal perception. Now, it's different from dating a black man, but now you're married to a black man. Emotionally, how did that play out for you in public? Do you understand the question?
Kind of, I guess.
Were there any insecurities? Were there anything that, was there anything there?
You know what? Honestly, I've never really had a problem with being approached because I'm dating a black man. Growing up, and I never felt insecure in that because I always felt that love does transcend color.
Right.
But I have my fears now, and that's what's scary. And it's not because I'm with a black man, but it's because you are a black man and you are my husband. And now with all the crimes and the things that are happening, you know, just making sure that you come home sometimes, it's like, it's hard, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Like the other day, you got a ticket, and I told you, were like, dang, $180 now. I got
for a seatbelt.
But you know, what did I tell you? At least it's a ticket, yeah. Just a ticket.
Yeah.
Because my first thought was when you told me you got a ticket or you were getting a ticket, the cops had pulled up or whatever, was like, oh my goodness, let nothing happen.
I don't know if white people go through that. I don't know if white men go through that when they get pulled over. If those, even if it's not a reality, even if it's just a perception between you and I, those fears, like, I literally start going through anxiety when I get pulled over. Like,
yeah, and I never felt that until now.
Yeah.
With all these incidences happening. Not that it hasn't happened in the past, you know, but it's just more so increasing as far as how often within our own region here.
And sometimes without even provocation. Sometimes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Go get, show me your license and registration, and boom, boom, there you are, dead.
Yeah.
Because you were doing what they're telling you to do, going in your pocket to get your license and registration as they requested, you know. Or say you got out the car and, oh man, this dude is really big, he's intimidating, he's a super, what is it, super villain, super monster,
super predator. Yeah,
he's a super predator, you know. You got fear on both sides.
Yeah.
Now, and that's a really bad, unstable combination.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have police etiquette. That was something, again,
I don't think that matters.
Well, I come from an LA culture where the LAPD in the 80s was real. Like, they had a gang unit who operated like a gang themselves. So it was always drilled into me. Keep your hands on the steering wheel. Speak only when spoken to. You, sir, at the end of it, do everything to make yourself and present yourself as unaggressive as possible. I know that's not a word, but that's programmed in me. And that's why I still deal with anxiety, because that was planted in me. And so when you and I seen the recent events of police officers, not, again, ladies and gentlemen, we're not generalizing all police officers, but we're just dealing with the feelings of what we feel and the videos that we've seen where it is plausible, and it does, and it has happened in terms of men getting killed over the simplest infractions. Those things, just as like it affects my wife, it affects me, and I'm in that position to the point where I'm calling my wife, like, "Hey, yo, I'm pulled over on the side of the road. Somebody's pulling up on me. Just stay on the phone, just in case I get shot. I want somebody to know that, because I'm a truck driver, so I'm out there by myself. Something happens to me, nobody will know until maybe a day or so later."
Mm-hmm.
So. These are the things, again, I don't know if white men deal with this, or they prepare for this, or they have these type of conversations with their kids. Like, I don't know
either.
I don't know. I
know, definitely as a Hispanic, Yeah, no, I've never had this conversation. I've never heard my dad have these conversations with my brothers. Yeah. I don't get it.
And so, it doesn't help that I'm 6'2", you know, 300 plus pounds.
You're
so
a super predator.
I fit the profile like a mug. You know what I mean? And so, yeah.
Even on your happy days, you look mean, huh?
Try not to. Shout out to the Holy Ghost. Interfering. What I appreciate is that I can have these conversations with you, but other people in other interracial relationships, like, I can't imagine, and I don't know what other race, but if a black man has a wife that's other, for right now, is an other, I don't know how much he can express, yo, it may not be a reality, but this is how I'm feeling. And she can sympathize with that, like, yeah, I see what you're going through. You know what I mean? And that's why you and I can have it. Like, I feel comfortable having conversations with you because, again, I don't have to come from factual, like, I feel like I'm being targeted. You know, that's not the case. But based on, as a culture, I'm feeling the pain of Philando Castile. You know, I'm feeling the pain of Walter Scott. Like, I see that, and I see my uncles and my brothers and whatnot. It's a shame that I feel closer to my African-American family through pain and struggle than I do with anything else, because I feel like that's more prevalent in America in terms of things that's happening unilaterally. Like, I don't see... I forgot the brother's name. I sent you the clip of him being on the ground with his hands up with the special needs kid. Hey, don't shoot him. And they end up shooting him.
And he asked them, officer, why did you shoot me? Like, literally the whole time he had his hands up.
Yo.
Trying to, you know, encourage this boy to...
Stop moving.
So they can go back to the group home or something like that. Home. Yeah, he had a little toy truck. You know, and
he was worried that he was gonna get shot.
Yeah, he was worried that the boy was gonna get shot.
And so when I saw that, we're not gonna mention every single time this has happened, but it's like I didn't send you the other clip of South Carolina, not Walter Scott, but another guy was told he was outside of his car, told to get his driver's license. He reached in the car to get his driver's license. He was standing up with his hands up, and a police officer starts shooting him as he was reaching to get it. And so he shot him in the leg a couple of times. And the dude was like, why'd you shoot me? He's like, I was reaching for my driver's license like you told me to do. And he didn't have an answer for that. And so when I see stuff like that, I'm like, I identify. I know where you're going. I know this fear because I know what it feels like to be seen as a threat. Do you remember when you took me to Greer for the first time? Not Greer. Eden, North Carolina for the first time. And we got lost. And we stopped at a restaurant to get direction. And it was a lady, the waitress, she was cleaning the tables. Do you remember that? She was cleaning the tables. And I was on the other side. It wasn't a Waffle House. I don't know what type of restaurant it was, but it was a big clear window. And I knocked on the window to get her attention. And she was like, not today.
They wouldn't open the door.
She wouldn't open the door. And yeah. I was cool with that. I was like, yeah. I can hear you through the window. Let me just ask you, hey, which way? And I was trying to communicate with her. She looked at me, gave me a long stare, and went right to the back. She said, not today. And I'm like, it's not that she was racist, but I know what she saw when she saw me at that time of night. You know what I mean? It doesn't help that she's a female, but I'm sure she wasn't there alone. You know what I mean? So I'm the threat, or I'm perceived as a threat. And so that those type of things, sometimes those conversations in a relationship.
I mean, how about you just walking in a restaurant of all bikers? And so now you got male and male, but you are the other. It was one, you, versus all of them.
Yeah, that I've been in that situation so many different times.
You know, you walk in the restaurant, and you have to walk right back out.
Yeah, it's not a very comfortable environment where the KKK or Hell's Angels are prevalent. You know what I mean? And ladies and gentlemen, you don't realize how there's not a lot of black people. There are a lot of black people in concentrated areas, mostly in metro cities. But when you start getting to the rest of the United States and these more open areas, we're sparse. It's been many times where I'm the only person. But again, like, I'm not married to a black woman, but I can share these feelings with you. And I feel like you understand based on what I communicate with you, and you sympathize with that. And it's like, you don't try to change my perspective or say that, you know, this is wrong or outlook or blah, blah, blah. Like, no, you get where I'm coming from. So that's dope. But again, a lot of people in other interracial relationships, they may not get that kind of comfort. They may not even be able to talk politics or race, especially race in an interracial relationship. Like, that's off limits.
Or criticize my sweet cornbread and be okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, her cornbread was terrible. Oh, that joint was horrible. The first time she made cornbread for me, but it was such a sweet gesture. And I have one more thought before we conclude. So Bel cooked dinner for me, and she made some greens, some cornbread.
I was trying to transcend the barriers
for the first time.
Trying to whip up some soul food.
And Lord have mercy.
Pork chops, collard greens, and cornbread.
You had potato salad too, didn't you?
I might have. I don't remember that one, but I remember the other stuff.
Yeah, it didn't work out very well. But she kept going, and she's there now. But that first time, you know, yeah, we just had to. She just had to change her seasoning.
There's an art to soul food.
That's all. That's all. Change of seasoning. You know, she had to get some of that that loving.
Whatever.
But our last comment before we get out of here. We'll begin about 10 minutes on this subject. So we have kids. We have a daughter. And
yes, we do.
Another challenge.
You said kids with an S.
See, I was trying to push through that, and you put light on that.
Joke. Oh yeah, baby Owen, the teddy bear, recent addition from Build-A-Bear and Tommy.
So I never perceived this to be an issue. It never even crossed my mind. And then we have a child. We have a daughter. And we're filling out forms, and now we have to label who she is from an ethnicity standpoint or race. You know, whether it's a YMCA form or whether it's a school, mostly school forms or medical
doctor forms. Doctor forms,
And what do you call our daughter? Who do you, like, so I never, I knew that, okay, let me backtrack.
I told her when she was with me, she's Hispanic.
And
that's it.
It's just that. It's just that plain and dry for you.
I mean, she's with you, she's black. I mean, I don't really care because I've always wanted her to identify herself.
Right.
And, I mean, I don't want to, like, that's just not something I want to focus on at this point in her life.
It's not something that I want to focus on. However, something that I am aware of in the black community, we have so many people. And there's a prevalent there's an attitude out there that people are really go happy-go-lucky when it comes to claiming other races as being part of their identity. And it makes it feel like you're
less... Like everyone has Indian in their family?
Like everybody has Indian in their family. And so it makes it less... You're lessening the experience or the actuality of you just being... Like, it's okay just to be black. It's okay just to be African American. You don't need to be mixed with anything.
Is that like the white person that says, "Yeah, I'm Italian," or Irish?
No, because I feel like they're accurately describing where they come from. Then that's it's like a white person saying that they're white and maybe Asian. You know, they're adding a whole completely different ethnicity into their mix to make them seem like there's something special to that. You know what I mean? As if just being Irish alone is not special enough.
And
for us, you got curly hair, you must have Indian in your family. No, why? I just can't be black and have curly hair. What's so special about curly hair? You know what I mean? We're talking about the difference between kinky hair and the big loose curls that...
Kinky curls. They're all curls now. Kinky right. curls, or your wavy curls, or your more loose curls.
Who cares about the texture? But the
3 A's, 4 A's, B's.
Oh yeah,
those are curl patterns.
Yeah, I was gonna say you get deep into it. But that's what I'm saying. So because of that attitude that's out there of people claiming other ethnicities, I never wanted our daughter to be a part of that spectrum where she has to feel she's gonna downgrade one and uplift the other, or that just because she's mixed, that makes her special. No, that don't make you special. But the opposite is actually starting to happen, where other people are putting race on her, and other people are identifying her and causing her to choose, and that's what makes me upset. Like, yo,
she's
not even getting that at home, and y'all put that on her.
Yeah.
And it's black folks.
Yeah.
It's black folks is doing that, and it's like, y'all can't do that. Y'all can't shame somebody based on where they come from.
You know? No, I mean? You're not part of us. You're an other.
You're an other. You mm-hmm. know what I mean? And it's like, no, you can't do that. I don't understand it. But I understand, and it's mostly kids. We're not talking about adults, but kids having that mentality. I guess.
Well, how many adults look at her the same way? To a certain extent, I think they're a little bit more sensitive because they understand that mommy's daddy's mix.
Yeah.
You know, but the perception is that, yeah, she's an other.
I don't like that. But these are the things that we have to deal with because this is the reality of our family.
And I honestly would have thought that this would have been a more embracing community, being that this is a military community. And I mean, there's just so much mixing of races within this area here that you would never know what anybody is, really.
Oh, the ratio in Fayetteville is nuts. It's really balanced in terms of, well, let me say this, between black and white populations.
Black, white, Hispanic, whoever, Asian.
Yeah.
You know, you got a lot of Middle Eastern people now here too that are popping up. So.
But we're still in the South. And I think that, you know, unfortunately, the culture of the South is still prevalent.
That undertone.
Yeah. And so, you know, calling our daughter something again that we don't even call her. And so what we try to do to combat that is just give her history on both sides and say, yo, you know, for me, I introduced little, she wants to be an engineer. So I show her African-American engineers like Benjamin Banneker. We're going to get into more architect types. The cat that built Washington, D.C. I can't call his name right now. The architect. What's his name? I think he built Chicago, too. Anyway, but these type of people, in order for her to feel a sense of pride in the African-American side, and then for the Puerto Rican side, I give her the food, the language, and the music so that she doesn't feel out of place and that there's a, you know, identifying. So I want her to have it all. Because that is who she is. And I mean, that's just the way our family makeup is. But when you're in an interracial relationship, it's just difficult sometimes to take that hurdle. And that, like, two black parents, two white parents, two Asian parents, they don't have to worry about that. They don't have to think about how their family is going to be identified. The redeeming factor. What's the redeeming factor of this episode?
Watch out. I think he had Deacon Moore in his license plate tag. It says, watch out.
The redeeming factor for me is coming from Genesis chapter 2. I'm not going to quote it verbatim, but it essentially said that the two shall be one flesh. And from a spiritual, psychological aspect, just because the two becomes one flesh, it doesn't mean that you become the same person. It means that now you have to work towards helping and working with one another and sharing your experiences so that both experience becomes unified. And I think that's the biggest thing, whether you have a best friend as your husband or wife, or if your husband and wife are from Zimbabwe, or, you know, whatever the case may be, it's your relationship, and your relationship now has become unified through your mutual experiences and through your mutual love. And it doesn't happen just because you say I do. You don't become a single person in that moment. It takes the X amount of time it takes for you all to reach that, you know,
continuous work.
So we thank you, we appreciate you, everyone. Continue listening. We'll be out next week. You're listening to the Hawk&bel podcast on YouTube. Bel, thank you. Love you.
Greg, thank you. Love you.
All right, y'all. Peace.
Yes.
Jesus loves me.
Yes. Jesus loves me.
Yes. Jesus loves me.
For the Bible tells me so.
You know. Lord, you know me before I I knew myself. All my mistakes, my decisions, my reasons, my thoughts and my wealth. You know what I do before I even do it. You know what I say before I even say it. You know, you know, you know.
You know it all.
You know, you know, you know.
I know you know.
You know, you know, you know.
You know it all.
You know, you know, you know.
I know you know.
You know, you know, you know.
You know it all.
You know, you know, you know.
I know it all.
You know, you know, you know.
You know it all.
You know, you know, you know. I dreamt of a Ferrari, and heaven goes left and the right. Blowing that money all night, oh, we do it all night. Some just didn't feel right. Took me some time just to figure out why. I'm so happy that I realized nothing else satisfies, yeah. Cause you know, you know, you know.
I know you know.
You know, you know, you know. I'm so glad you gave that key. Open that door, show me that victory. You know the outcome of my destiny. Painted a picture so now I can see. Oh my God, we made it. Oh God, we made it. I'm grateful for now I can see. Hands in the air for what all now set free. Oh my God, we made it. Oh God, we made it. I'm grateful for now I can see. Hands in the air for what all now set free. Cause you know, you know, you know. You know, you know, you know. Cause you know, you know, you know.
You know it.
You know, you know, you know. I dreamt just of the Paris. Sipping Cornier on my yacht. Thought this was the life that I wanted. Your life would be sweet if I got it all. Doesn't feel right. Took me some time just to figure out why. I'm so happy that I realized, oh, nothing else satisfied. Cause you know, you know, you know.
I know you know.
You know, you know, you know. Cause you know, you know, you know. You know, you know, you know.
I know.
We were meant to be rich, not material things, but pure gold in the inner mind. In my heart, looking for the finer things, chasing after the world, pride, lust, and it's in the mind. Life changed, Christ came at the winner mind. By fate, I'm saved, new beginner mind. I'm so grateful, got a second chance. Life is a vapor, and things of this world, we don't need it. You know, you know, you know. You know, you know, you know. Cause you know, you know, you know. You know, you know, you know.
I know you know.
Thank you.